So Joe, we've returned to the same cubicle again.
We have. It's changed slightly. We've got a new wall, new neighbours.
Yeah. Yeah, which makes it a little bit darker for us. We're going to do the insulation resistance test of our lighting circuit.
Yep, absolutely.
And there's lots of things, isn't there, Joe, that we've got to consider.
Yeah, this is not a simple lighting circuit by any means. This is fairly complex. We've got a couple of light fittings on here. We've got some delicate components that we need to be careful about. And we've also got intermediate switching thrown into the mix as well, which is going to add to our testing quite a lot. So what sort of things are we going to have to be careful of, Gaz, very specifically?
As the insulation resistance test is going to pass 500 volts DC through the circuit, we're going to have to be careful, as always, to make sure the RCCB in this case, which is in our consumer's unit, is in the off position.
Yep.
But we've also got an issue at the light, haven't we, Joe?
Yeah, absolutely. Because in here, this has got an electronic ballast, which means that there's delicate electronic components in here.
Yeah.
If we were to pass 500 volts across the line in neutral terminals of this, we would potentially fry those. So we do need to exercise a little bit of caution when we carry out that test.
Also, as we move towards AM2 and AM2S, regardless how the two-way or two-way intermediate circuit is wired in conduit or in PVC twin and CPC, they said to us when we went to the Luton Centre that there's some things they'd like us to do in our training.
Yeah.
Well, we've left this job, we've come back to it, haven't we, Joe? Over a period of time, we've left it, and we've got a one-way switch controlling a fluorescent light fitting, but we've also got two-way and intermediate switching down this side. Are they on?
Well, this is the point. We don't know now. So when we did our continuity of CPC test, normally what we'd do is we would leave the switches in the on position.
We would.
We know then we've got every scrap of cable being tested, and we know all we've got to do is put the two-way switches into the other on position. However, because now we don't know whether this is off or on, we don't know whether we're testing every scrap of cable or not. So how are we going to get over that, Gaz? What's the guidance that we need to follow on this? Where are we working to?
When we're at the AM2 test centre, he said for ease of them to standardise their practice, they work from guidance notes 3.
Yep.
And guidance notes 3 says where there's two-way or two-way and intermediate switching and you're carrying out an insulation resistance test, you will carry out the test and operate each switch individually, repeating the test after each switch has been thrown.
Yeah.
It is a little bit longer, but let's standardise that practice as we're all working towards that AM2 or AM2S.
Absolutely,
Okay.
Yeah, that way when we walk into the AM2 or AM2 test, AM2S test centre, we're crushing it, aren't we? We know exactly what we've got to do. We're not going to be thrown off by, you know, someone saying, what about this two-way switching? We'll know that's the next step on this test.
So what we'll do is we'll bring the camera in and show you what we've done in the fluorescent light fitting to remove the electronic ballast.
Yep.
We'll reiterate the fact that we've turned the RCCB off, and we'll just look at these switches before we carry out the insulation resistance test.
Let's do it.
So Joe, I'm looking inside the fluorescent light fitting and I can see you've disconnected the conductor for me. Can you explain what's happened there?
So what we've done is we've disconnected the switching line out of the light fitting itself. So what's happening now is when we do our insulation resistance test, we're not going to be connecting 500 volts across the line and the neutral terminal that connects onto the electronic ballast. So what that's going to do is it's basically going to make sure that we test the entire circuit, but it's also going to keep our piece of kit here safe from harm. It's not going to get damaged. We could have disconnected the neutrals if we so desired, but in this case, because we've only got the one line conductor going into the switching line terminal, it makes sense that that was the one that we took out and just put into a little connector block. Now, the other thing just to bear in mind, what we're going to do here is we're going to box this back up, because of course it's when we screw fronts on, when we box stuff up, that's when we, the electrician, are most likely to cause a fault when we measure our insulation resistance. So we'll box this back up before we do the test.
Thank you, Joe. So Joe, I'm at the mains end here, and we can see it's important that before we carry out the insulation resistance test that we're connected to the external earth source. So we've actually got our earthing conductor connected to an MET. And as we pan up to the consumer's unit, Joe, we've reiterated a point in the introduction that the RCCB needs to be in which position?
The RCCB needs to be switched off. And again, that's because this contains delicate components which could be damaged by the 500 volts DC current that we're going to pass across this.
And we also expect our learners to leave the circuit breakers off, because remember, when you probe onto the top terminals carrying your insulation resistance test, it doesn't realise whether it's going out and up and through the circuit or down through the circuit breaker.
So it could
itself.
Come through here and again cause damage on this side if we're not careful.
So again, for AM2 and AM2S, make sure that all electronic components are either disconnected or turned off in this case.
So what we're looking at here, we've got our one-way switch that is controlling our fluorescent light. And here we've left this switch in the on position, so we know that's switched on, which means when we carry out our insulation resistance test, we're testing the permanent line conductor that comes down to the switch, but we're also testing the return switch line conductor as well, which means that we've covered every scrap of insulation that is on that bit of the circuit.
So Joe, we've panned round to our two-way and intermediate section of the switching. We understand they're very close together in this training simulation, but the test itself is still going to be exactly the same as it would be in industry. Can you confirm whether we're on or off at the moment, Joe?
Well, this is the challenge we've got. Because we've stepped away from the installation and then we've come back to it, and actually it's been some days in reality since we've done that, we now have no idea if these switches have been tampered with, if someone's pressed them and operated them. So we simply don't know if this circuit is now in the on or off position.
It wouldn't be wise as an electrician now to come back into the installation and start doing his continuity or CPC combined with polarity tests just to prove they're back on, would it?
No, it wouldn't be sensible. You'd have to start taking the circuit apart again. And also, it's not time efficient. You're going to be disconnecting the circuit, doing the test that you've already done, and then reconnecting it. It's not a very, very sensible option. So what we'll do is we'll follow the advice given to us in guidance note 3 by operating the switches one at a time, repeating the tests, and that way we can be confident we've tested every scrap of insulation that's covering the copper conductors on this circuit.
And we know that's expected at AM2 and AM2S as well, so it's standardised best practice.
Critical point that, let's remember that going into our test, folks.
So, Joe, we're at the consumer's unit now. All our covers have been returned, all our loads have been removed. We know our one-way switch is in the on position. We're unsure about the two-way and intermediate switching positions, so we're ready to start the insulation resistance test according to guidance notes 3. Can you set up the tester for me, please, Joe?
Yeah, absolutely. First thing we're going to do is check that the tester and the leads are in no way damaged, make sure there's no cracks in the housing, make sure there's no insulation missing, split or damaged on the leads there. Once we're happy that the equipment is fit for purpose, we're going to select our voltage range. Now, we are testing a 230 volt circuit, and according to BS 7671, we need to test this at 500 volts. So we've set this to 500 volts DC. So now when we press the test button, we will be applying 500 volts DC across the ends of these two probes. So we just need to make sure at this point that we're a little bit careful, because while this isn't enough of a supply to do a serious injury, it still hurts if you get 500 volts from one of these kits across you, so we'll avoid that. So what we'll do first of all is we'll just make sure that the meter is working. So we're not zeroing our leads here, but all we're doing is just making sure that the leads are functional. So there we go. So we've got a very, very low reading. And then if we disconnect, we get a very, very high reading. So we're really happy there that the instrument is working, that the leads are continuous. As I say, that wasn't zeroing the leads. We're expecting to get a value in the mega ohm or millions of ohms range, which means that any small amount of resistance within these leads is not going to affect the overall reading. So we've got the meter set up. What we'll do now is we'll proceed to test the circuit.
Okay, Joe, so we're ready to carry out the test, and you're going to try as hard as you can to stay out of the way of the camera as you connect on to carry out the sequence, please, for the insulation resistance test. Remembering there is no particular order in which to probe onto, as long as we cover all three conductors during the test.
Okay, so we'll make a start then. We're going to test between, as you say, all three combinations of conductors. So I'm going to start off by testing between line and earth. So we'll clip onto the earth bar there. So we're going to be testing between line and CPC, obviously. That's the CPC. So we will connect onto that terminal there. Now, what you always want to make sure of when you're doing this test is that you're actually making contact between the metalwork of the terminal and the actual tip of the probe, because sometimes this PVC can actually stop you from making contact. It can kind of sit on the head of the screw. So I always like to just make sure I'm actually touching the metalwork of the terminal. And if we just slide that out of the way and press the test button, we should get a reading there. So we can see we're getting a reading of 999 megaohms. It has the little greater than symbol there, but we could just put a plus 999 megaohms in the test result box. I like to leave my clip onto the earth bar there. So we'll test now between CPC and neutral. And again, we should get a nice high reading, again, greater than 999 megaohms. And then finally, we've got one more test to do, which is between line and neutral. So we'll clip onto the neutral bar there and put our probe carefully into that hole, press the test button. And once again, we're getting greater than 999 megaohms. So that's our first round of insulation resistance testing done.
So Joe, that's the first round of insulation resistance testing on this lighting circuit. However, because we have two-way and intermediate switching, I think you're gonna have to walk out into the installation and do what for me?
So what we're gonna have to do now is follow the guidance that we're given in guidance note 3. Guidance note 3 states that where we've got two-way or two-way and intermediate switching, we have to operate the switches one at a time and then repeat the tests. Now again, we could kind of argue the validity of doing some of these things. We're gonna test between neutral and CPC in line and neutral every time we operate a switch again. Potentially in this circuit, the neutral might not go anywhere near these two-way and intermediate switches. However, in a different installation, we may well be running the neutral next to those conductors. So for what we're gonna do here, in order to ensure that we hit every test that we need to do, we're going to make sure that we carry out all three combinations of test every time we operate one of the switches. So let's get started. So we'll operate the first of our switches and then we'll repeat the three insulation resistance tests.
So Joe's walked out into the installation, operated the switch and is now returned back to the consumer's unit. Remembering the supply is not connected to the consumer unit as the tails were disconnected at the meter's end, and we're going to subject the circuit to the tests once again.
So as we did before, I'm going to clip onto the earth bar here, test between line and CPC. So we clip on there, carry out the test, and once again we're getting greater than 999 mega ohms. Leaving that clip on there, we're now going to test between neutral and CPC. Once again, we're getting greater than 999 mega ohms. And then we're going to move that onto the neutral bar and we're going to test between neutral and line. And again, we're getting greater than 999 mega ohms. So that's the second round of testing completed after we've operated the first switch. So now we're going to go and we're going to operate the second of our two-way and intermediate switching. So we'll operate the switch. And now we'll carry out the three tests once more.
So as you're watching this and Joe is carrying out all three again, what we've got to remember is that we're not trying to eliminate doing parts of the test, remembering things like neutrals are often taken to switches in domestic dwellings. If the wiring for this circuit was in conduit, it uses a different wiring method, and often the conductors can pass the neutral conductor. So we're leaving all three to be tested in each of the sequences.
So once again, we've done all three tests there, and all three tests were greater than 999 megaohms. So now we'll operate the third of our two-way intermediate switches, and we'll carry out the three tests once more. So we'll test between line and CPC. Now, just a small point to note here. It's very good practice when you're carrying out this test to release the test button before you remove your probe from the terminal. Now, the reason for that is that you've got quite long runs potentially of a twin and CPC cable, and this can actually start to act a little bit like a capacitor. And because we're passing a DC current into our circuit, it can actually charge it up with some potential discharge of electricity. And if you've charged it up, removed your probes, and then you touch across what is assumed to be a dead circuit, you can actually get a little shock off there, the same as you would off a capacitor. Probably not enough to do any serious harm, but certainly enough to make you jump. And that could obviously lead on to further things. So it's best practice when we do the test, pop the probe onto the terminal, press the test button, and then if you release the test button, the current will actually discharge back through the meter again quite safely, meaning that you don't have that capacitive effect going on. So now we'll just carry out the last of our three tests.
Another point I'd say for your AM2 and AM2S is also, you wouldn't want to be holding the button and anywhere near the ends of the leads. If the instructor was to see you pass 500 volts through yourself, he would suggest you're not working safely and would fail you that element of the test as well.
So that's all three tests done, and we've operated all three switches. So we've carried out all our insulation resistance testing. Now at this point, it's very important that we go back into our circuit and we reconnect any of those sensitive loads that we disconnected the first time around, so that when we power the circuit up, we've got this back up and running again and operational. Now at this point, we might get people saying, well, if you've taken the lid off and then put it back on again, you'd need to carry out the insulation resistance test again. Obviously, we'd get stuck in an endless loop there, and that's just going to be pointless. We've taken every precaution that we can, and we've carried out the test into the most extreme point that we possibly can do. And at this point, we've got to be satisfied with the results that we've got.
So we've completed the insulation resistance test of our lighting circuit.
Yep.
Our lighting circuit had two-way and intermediate switching, and we approached it differently than I had done in any of my other video presentations. What's the thinking behind that, Joe?
The thinking behind that is that we want to make sure when you go in to carry out your AM2 or your AM2S, you have the information you need in order to pass that particular qualification. For me, carrying out insulation resistance testing has one purpose, and that is to make sure that the resistance of the insulation covering all of those conductors is doing its job. To that end, you need to make sure that you have tested every section of insulation. Carrying it out the way we did in Gary's previous video will achieve that. Carrying it out the way we did in this video will also achieve that. However, the way that we've done it in this video is according to the instruction in Guidance Note 3, which we believe is a standard that is used in the AM2 and AM2S test centres in order to produce some standardisation that the assessors can work to.
It's a conversation you can have with him, I think, yeah. Or her, the person doing your examination, is that you can suggest the way you'd like to do it, maybe it's the way that we've originally done it, mm-hmm. or you can suggest perhaps the way yeah. in Guidance Note 3. I think an adult conversation between the two of you suggests you know what you're doing.
And you're demonstrating your understanding and your knowledge, again, of the purpose of the test. So if you're thinking about what you're doing and you're carrying it out in a way that does achieve the passing of the resistance of the insulation, then you've carried out that test correctly. However, if you're approaching an AM2 or your AM2S, really we need to be thinking about what does Guidance Note 3 tell us to do.
And we know from BS7671 the smallest acceptable value of insulation resistance is
1 megaohm. However, Gaz, if you were at a new installation, what value would you be looking for ideally?
Looking to Guidance Notes 3, if that's what they're using at the AM2 and AM2S centres, it says here that a brand new circuit, which we've installed and you will do on an AM2 and AM2S, must have an insulation resistance above 20 megaohms, because at 20 megaohms, you've got to do further investigation at that stage. We know BS7671 says under normal installations, when the whole installation's insulation resistance falls below 2 megaohms, mm-hmm. then we're obviously going to carry out further investigation.
Yeah.
So they're key points, I think, to be demonstrating to your examiner that you know.
Again, you've got that range of knowledge of the answers. You're not just firing back one answer. You're actually giving a considered answer that shows knowledge across various different documents.
We're also going to do the same similar test when we do a conduit exercise, aren't we? Mm-hmm. And we're going to have two-way switching on there. And we'll repeat both processes again when we get to those videos. So we're trying our hardest to add some AM2 and AM2S stuff in. Mm-hmm. And I think time, Joe, to say.
Shall we do it?
We shall.
We hope this video has been some help.